Welcome back, everybody. Western New York is home to a number of farms, and many of them, for the most part, look pretty similar.
Mike Randall is checking out a new type of farm in Hamburg, trying to push the profession into the future.
The glowing structure has been puzzling many a nighttime passerby.
Everyone's pretty curious about what's going on over here with it being lit up. It's lit up 16 hours a day.
Don't worry, you haven't stepped into the Twilight Zone. We're stepping into Jason Henry's experiment.
It is an experiment. So we started pretty small scale a year ago with 100 gullies. We call these trough gullies.
Jason is a member of the Kenneth Henry Sons Farm, known for their flowers. He's taken a little bit of a detour.
It stays under LED lights to encourage growth.
He's put together an operation to grow lettuce.
And then at day 14, we transplant it into the main hydroponic system here.
Hydroponic, that means in water, no dirt.
Where water is continuously running 24/7.
He starts with seeds, and within 60 days, lettuce is ready to harvest.
So this is the heart of the operation here. This is our nutrient reservoir. So at any given time, there's 250 gallons of water in the tank here.
With the plants growing 24/7, there's a constant new crop to harvest.
We've got it scheduled, so there's a fresh crop of 700 plants coming on every week.
Jason is turning out 5 varieties of lettuce.
Red leaf, a red Boston. Here you have our green leaf. This is our fan favorite. This is the variety that we do the most of per week.
The small greenhouse can produce 40,000 heads of lettuce per year. That's over 16,000 pounds of fresh, local lettuce.
And the really cool part is, no matter how cold it is outside, it's always 65 degrees and sunny in here.
Jason's lettuce can be purchased right across the street at Braymiller's Market.
We're looking for new ideas. We're trying to be creative.
If you're curious about the future of farming, it's already here in Hamburg.
We're definitely thinking about expanding it in the future.
Mike Randall, 7 Eyewitness News.
In this morning's GMA First Look, end of an era. Jeff Bezos, founder of Amazon, announcing he's stepping down. The man who started Amazon in 1994, building it from an online bookstore into a global giant worth more than $1.6 trillion.
Trying to find a product that actually matched the internet technology. That was really the key. Because right now, the web is still a fairly immature platform.
Changing the way we shop, stream, and get our deliveries. Announcing he'll leave his role as CEO later this year. The idea for Amazon has made Bezos one of the wealthiest people on the planet, worth an estimated $196.4 billion. So what will this change do to Amazon stock? And what's next for one of the world's richest people? It's all coming up at 7 a.m. With your GMA First Look, I'm Rebecca Jarvis, ABC News, New York.
Rich, indulgent chocolate with a luscious caramel filling. With love from San Francisco. Ghirardelli Caramel Squares makes life a bite better.
Millions are saying yes to Allegra, the number one allergist recommended non-drowsy brand. Allegra works 2 times faster than Claritin, and unlike Zyrtec, it's non-drowsy. Say yes to the fastest non-drowsy 24-hour relief, Allegra.
At Panera, we didn't just raise the bar. With warm roasted chicken, fresh broccoli, and a savory glaze, we raised the bar on the bowl. Order our new teriyaki chicken and broccoli bowl for delivery or pickup today. Panera.
All new this morning on 7 Eyewitness News at 6. How long will it take Erie County to reschedule all of those canceled vaccination appointments? What you need to know about the process.
So I'm just hopeful that one of these days I'll be lucky. It's like the lottery. I'll just be lucky and get an appointment.
Plus, why the wait to get the vaccine may now be even longer for some. And who's being added to the eligibility list?
Courtesy call to renew your warranty.
How many of those calls have you gotten recently? There's a trick to stopping them that could save you a ton of money.
You're going to find partly cloudy skies, chilly start your day today, sunny and breezy this afternoon. This weekend, though, cold with lake effect snow, and some of that lake effect could be significant.
Then later, we're giving you a closer look at the new idea to bring the Broadway Market back to its former glory, bringing it and the neighborhood into a new era. 7 Eyewitness News at 6 starts right now. Now broadcasting and streaming live from 7 Broadcast Plaza, this is 7 Eyewitness News at 6.
Good morning, everyone. Thanks for joining us on your Wednesday. A lot of news to get to today. You know, Ed, you hear about people getting so frustrated over the vaccination, and then when you hear someone describe it as they're so lucky that they're winning the lottery, that just puts it in perspective for you.
Right. A lot of frustration, a lot of people just trying to get that appointment and having no luck, though the state is getting some more vaccination delivered within the next couple of weeks, so that'll be some good news. We'll touch on that coming up in just a little while. Aaron Minkowski tracking that 7 First Alert forecast for us. And Aaron, all the highs today before the low lows.
That's right. Enjoy today. Today and tomorrow we'll have sunshine, temperatures in the 30s, kind of quiet weather across the area before things change for the end of the week and the weekend. You look at our 7 Super Doppler. We had that snow last night. Continued into very early this morning. Now those snow showers are pulling off to our east. We'll look outside in downtown Buffalo. You have partly cloudy skies, 23 chilly degrees, winds out of the north-northwest around 12 miles per hour, 22 in Niagara Falls, 20 right now in Jamestown. Winds will be an issue today, gusting around 20 miles per hour. So we'll have a cool breeze for your Wednesday. Hour by hour forecast showing a mix of sun and clouds across the area today. We'll have a good deal of sunshine on Thursday before that next system rolls in Thursday night into Friday. Here's a look at your takeout forecast then for today. Temperatures will be in the upper 20s around lunchtime with partly cloudy skies. Sunshine this afternoon. Temperatures near 30 degrees later today. So all in all, not a bad day today. Have the sunglasses and the jacket handy today and tomorrow. Quiet. We'll talk about that very active weather pattern for Friday and the weekend coming up in just a few.
Thank you, Aaron. All new for you this morning. We're now learning it'll take several weeks for Erie County to finish rescheduling canceled COVID-19 vaccination appointments from the last 2 weeks. Right now, the county is in the process of emailing everyone who needs to reschedule their appointment. They say if you book the appointment for yourself, you cannot give it away to a family member, and you have to be the one to be vaccinated. If you get an email to reschedule but can't make your new appointment, or if you got a shot someplace else, you need to let the county know as soon as possible. Erie County says it'll schedule more first dose appointments for phase 1B essential workers once they have the supply. That includes everyone you see here on your screen. These folks, along with the frontline healthcare workers and nursing home residents and staff, have first dibs when it comes to getting the COVID-19 vaccine, but many of them are still waiting to get their shot. Experts say at the rate vaccinations are being distributed, it could take several months for everyone in phase 1A and 1B to get that vaccine. But as our 7 Eyewitness News reporter Gilat Malamed is showing us, a bump in supply from the federal government may make even more people eligible for this shot.
The state says counties can expect 20% more doses of vaccine over the next 3 weeks.
So now there's additional flexibility, and I'm leaving it up to the local governments to make a determination of what fits their situation best.
Counties can choose to expand phase 1B eligibility to include people in developmentally disabled facilities, restaurant workers, and Uber and taxi drivers.
Congratulations, but you're not going to get a dose from Erie County anytime soon. And I say that not trying to be snarky about it, but it's just the facts.
Erie County says eligibility cannot expand there. This month's doses will help the county reschedule 9,000 appointments that were canceled due to low supply.
It's difficult for me to sit here and tell those people that you're going to be able to get a vaccine next week, because that's not just going to happen. It is not going to happen, at least in Erie County.
Counties across western New York are in similar situations. Niagara County writes it's far from vaccinating people already eligible, and without more supply, new groups would just add to confusion and frustration. This new expansion does not include people who are immunocompromised. Cuomo says the state is working with the CDC to define immunocompromised and add supply as an issue.
To now say to 4 million people, okay, you're eligible too, but you know, we're nowhere near being able to get to you. It's meaningless.
More vaccines are coming to pharmacies vaccinating people 65 and over. The federal government will directly supply them an additional 10%, meaning New York pharmacies will receive about 30,000 additional doses. In Buffalo, Gilat Malamed, 7 Eyewitness News.
As Gilat said, more doses coming to New York State will help speed up the process. New York is getting about 250,000 doses per week. Right now, more than 7 million New Yorkers, though, are eligible for a vaccine. Less than 1.5 million have received that first dose so far. While local and state health departments work to get more people vaccinated, about a million people are already in line for their second dose of the vaccine.
It's going to be complicated because we're doing both, but we need to be able to do that. So we'll get our first doses in, we'll schedule those, and we already have people who are scheduled for their second dose, at least for next week, and we'll do those too. So it's going to be a multi-pronged approach.
Each county gets separate shipments for first and second doses. The second shipments have the exact same amount as the first round of doses, and officials say it's important that each shot is used as intended.
They are different locations. They are not the same locations. So we know the individuals who are coming to the second dose clinic are there for a second dose.
So remember, one dose gives about 50% immunity of the virus. Getting both doses increases it to 90 to 95%. So experts say it's vital that you get both. Under a new federal program, pharmacies are now going to get doses straight from the federal government on top of the state's vaccine allowance. And because of this program, CVS is going to soon begin administering vaccines at 32 spots across the state. The company says the locations are going to split about 21,000 total doses. For now, the only participating pharmacies in Western New York are the CVS locations in Hamburg and Batavia. You can start booking appointments next Tuesday if you're eligible. But we know getting an appointment to get your shot is easier said than done. So coming up in our next half hour, we're looking into the major issues when it comes to signing up. We're also scouring the web to see what, if any, appointments are available near you. On top of the COVID-19 pandemic, Western New York is also dealing with an opioid epidemic, and it's only gotten worse over the past year. The Erie County Opioid Task Force says at least 200 people died of a drug overdose last year. That's up more than 33% from the year before, and more cases are still pending. While most of the cases are being found within the city of Buffalo, the suburbs are not far behind, seeing sharp increases as well.
Looking at the overdose numbers, when I look back historically, the numbers themselves didn't go higher, the lethality went higher.
To help track and potentially curb the number of overdose deaths, the county released a new interactive map showing where the opioid epidemic is hitting the hardest across Erie County. It also shows where you can get free Narcan boxes and refills, and we put a link for that tool right now for you on our website, WKBW.com. Ed?
6:07 on a Wednesday happening today, the Buffalo Police Department is reaching out to folks who live in the Elmwood Village in a virtual meeting addressing concerns in the community. This is something each district does monthly, but today the department's D district will specifically address crime in the Elmwood Village. That Zoom meeting starts at 11 o'clock this morning. This meeting comes 1 week after a man was stabbed in broad daylight in this surveillance video. You see it happen here right at the corner of Elmwood and West Ferry. Coming up in our next half hour, we're taking your concerns about crime in the Elmwood Village and what's being done to stop it to your elected leader. Our live, in-depth conversation with Councilman David Rivera is coming up at 6:45. It is a solemn morning in the nation's capital as the nation remembers a fallen police officer who died from his injuries suffered during the Capitol riot last month. He's now lying in honor in the building he gave his life protecting. You're looking live at the Capitol right now, where in about an hour from now, members of Congress will pay their respects to Officer Brian Sicknick. His family is now thanking lawmakers on Capitol Hill for the special honor of letting his remains lie in the Capitol Rotunda. In a statement, Sicknick's family also thanked Americans who've offered their sympathy and support. President Biden, along with others, paid their respects late last night. Officer Sicknick died of his injuries the day after the riot. His death is now being investigated as a murder. Still ahead for you this morning on 7 Eyewitness News, why one Buffalo public school is staying closed today despite fixing a busted water main. Plus, how tired are you of getting those annoying robocalls about your car warranty? We'll show you how you can put the brakes on it for good straight ahead. Plus this.
A student can come here and think, oh, I could be a pilot.
The changes to aviation helping more people of diverse backgrounds take flight. Aaron. Oh, actually, I'll take it from here. We'll take a live look at Skywatch 7 this morning. Aaron is timing out when you'll need to break out the shovels and add that extra layer after today's warm-up straight ahead. It's 6:09. Stay with us. You're watching 7 Eyewitness News.
Well, Welcome back, everybody. 612. Here's what's good to know before you go today. A Republican steering committee will meet again to decide whether or not to strip Congresswoman Marjorie Taylor Greene of her committee assignments. The group met last night, but they didn't come to a decision. The Georgia rep is under fire for her ongoing controversial comments. They include questioning whether the Parkland school shooting was staged and doubting that a plane really hit the Pentagon on 9/11. Just like many other businesses, oil companies hit hard by the pandemic. ExxonMobil reporting its biggest loss in history. In 2020, the company lost more than $22 billion. Meanwhile, BP lost $18 billion. Chevron reported $5.5 billion loss for the year. And a polar vortex expected to hit the country hard next week. The National Weather Service says it's expected to push a blast of cold air through the country starting in the upper Midwest. Places in central Wisconsin could see the temperature drop to 25 degrees below zero Sunday. Warmer places like Atlanta, Georgia, predicted to see a low of 19 degrees by Monday morning, the coldest temperature that city has seen in 3 years. You know, Aaron, we're feeling those cold temperatures here too as well.
Oh, we certainly are going to feel those cold temperatures. Take a look at this map here, and you can focus there on the blue over Canada. That is the cold air that's going to be spilling into western New York. It's going to roll across the Great Lakes and push its way through the area. We'll have a first blast of cold air this weekend with highs in the 20s for Saturday and Sunday, and then highs in the teens for Monday and Tuesday.
Thank you, Aaron. At 6:14, we have an eye on the state of education as pressure to reopen schools causes tension between politicians and unvaccinated educators. In Chicago, teachers are on the brink of a strike. In Cincinnati, a teachers' union lawsuit over safety concerns was thrown out. The stories are similar in many cities across the country, including here in Buffalo. Parents are split on the matter, some worried about safety, while others say their child isn't learning anything from online courses. Meantime, another water main break is keeping one Buffalo school closed today. The break at School 59A that kept students home yesterday has been resolved, but there's another water main break keeping students and staff remote until it's fixed. Are you getting those new robocalls on your cell phone this year? Many of us are, and it turns out most of them have nothing to do with your car or all to do with your car. Consumer reporter John Matarese is showing what you can do to stop them so you don't waste your money.
Have you ever answered your phone and heard something like this?
And this is a courtesy call to renew your warranty before we close the file.
It seems every day someone needs to reach you about your warranty expiring.
Hi there, this is Jessica calling in regards to your Volkswagen warranty.
Sometimes they even know the make of your car. How do they know that? They buy it from manufacturers in the state. But the FTC says buyer beware. In many cases, these are shady companies that may sell you a warranty your dealership won't honor. From the Doesn't That Stink file, the worst thing you can do when you get these calls, pressing one or two to opt out. That tells them you are a live person and you may get even more calls, and that stinks. Have an Apple iPhone? There's a secret setting to now block them. Go to Settings, then Phone, and look for Call Silencing. You can then silence unknown callers and they'll just go to your voicemail. Have an Android phone? Check with your cell provider on how to block unknown calls. If you want an extended warranty, talk to your dealer about which warranties they'll accept in their shop. That way, don't waste your money. I'm John Madry, 7 Eyewitness News.
Good advice, John, because I know a lot of people are getting those calls. New this morning, whether flying a commercial airplane or a military one, getting greater diversity among pilots has been an ongoing issue. Now a new bill that just passed in Congress could be key to turning that around. As it stands right now, the skies are hardly diverse. Among commercial pilots, 6% are women, only 10% are from communities of color. In the U.S. Air Force, the percentages are even smaller. A big factor is cost. Flight training is expensive, costing tens of thousands of dollars. But Congress recently passed the Flight Act. It provides new funding for students in ROTC programs at historically black universities, something the students are calling a game changer for the future.
Once they gave that to me, it was like a blessing because I didn't know how I was going to be able to do it until that happened.
This now opens a door for more students to pursue futures in the military and, of course, futures in flight. Do your kids love their PlayStation or their Xbox? I bet I know the answer to that. Well, how about if they could make their own controller for it? Is that something they'd be interested in? Because all new for you tomorrow morning, I'm going to show you a way that you can get your kids hands-on STEM lessons from home. I'll introduce you to Thimble. It's a Buffalo company selling kits with everything for kids to do STEM projects, and there are online lessons included. There is a real focus on what kids are interested in, like those video game controllers, for example. So I'm going to tell you all about that tomorrow morning. It really gets the gears turning for kids and keeps them interested in science, technology, engineering, and math while they're learning from home. And the pandemic has closed doors for so many parts of life that were normal to us, right? Like walking into an office for work, for example. Now I'm just walking up to the third floor. But switching to remote work is actually opening the doors for a lot of people when it comes to opportunities. It took Lisa Carter from Buffalo 5 years to find the job she wanted. She has a master's in business and she uses a wheelchair. She found that some employers didn't know how to accommodate her disability.
As I'm flashing back to an interview I had over the phone, and I asked, is there any opportunity to work from home? This was several years ago. And they're like, no, because of the way our mainframe and our systems work.
With the pandemic, many workplaces then had to adjust, proving that remote work can happen when necessary. That opens up opportunities for people like Lisa, who have obstacles traveling to an office every day. Love that story, Ed, opening opportunities. And we've all figured out that working from home just has to happen sometimes.
Yeah, we've been talking about how businesses and employers are going to have to adapt, and they're doing so. And that's great to see that everyone, no matter their ability, is getting the job. 619, let's look at what's trending this morning. Jeopardy is adding more names to its guest host roster, including Dr. Oz, Anderson Cooper, and Savannah Guthrie. Dr. Sanjay Gupta is also included on that list. The game show is being hosted by guest hosts since the death of Alex Trebek in November. Nominations for the 78th Golden Globes are expected to be announced this morning. For the first time, the Golden Globes will also be hosted on both the West and East Coasts, with many parts going virtual. Tina Fey will be live from New York, and Amy Poehler is in California. Still uncertain if anyone will be allowed to attend either location in person. So funny, I was just watching Mean Girls yesterday. It was on. Two of my favorite actresses all in one place. Gotta love it. Broadway theaters are still shut down, so instead, major musicals are being recreated so you can watch from home. The cast of the Tony winner Come From Away is set to reunite on a Broadway stage for a filmed version to be released in September. A movie version of Wicked is now gaining traction as well. Lin-Manuel Miranda's In the Heights, due out in theaters and on HBO Max in June, about a year after Hamilton was released on Disney Plus. This is so great. In fact, you guys, I was just thinking this morning about how I miss doing so many normal things, and it was about this time last year that Shades was able to put on its last show, Hello Dolly, one of my favorites. And, you know, so many people were in the theater all together. They've got so many seats. But that was really the last time we saw so many mass gatherings in our society. And, I'm so looking forward to getting back there, Katie.
I know, we're really waiting to see how all of that is going to shape up, because we know it's going to be different, but it's really exciting to hear that story. Come From Away was so wonderful. If you haven't seen it, this is a great opportunity, this film version. Yeah, absolutely. So mark that on your calendar for sure. Aaron, let's start getting everybody out the door this morning. We have an active weather weekend that we're already keeping our eyes on. It's just Wednesday.
Absolutely. Today and tomorrow will be rather quiet across the area, but when we get into Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, it is going to be active as far as the weather is concerned. You take a look at the radar right now. We had that snow last night. That snow is now off to our east, and it continues to make its way away from western New York. Right now, we have 23 chilly degrees, winds out of the northwest at 12 miles per hour, so it feels like 12 outside. 20 in Jamestown, 20 in Wellsville, 22 right now in Niagara Falls. Winds will gust near 20 miles per hour today, so you're going to feel that cool breeze across the region for your Wednesday. Mix of sun and clouds today. We clear out tonight. Tomorrow, we'll have a good deal of sunshine. The next system arrives Thursday night, and that'll roll through the area on Friday. Your hourly forecast for today, temperatures will be in the low 20s this morning. Partly sunny with a cool breeze. Your high this afternoon, 31 degrees. Hour by hour forecast, showing partly cloudy skies for today. Good deal of sunshine on Thursday, but let me stop the map here around 11:30 Thursday evening, and you'll see the leading edge of some snow and some freezing rain moving through. We'll have rain mixing with some snow Friday morning, changing to snow as we get into Friday evening and Saturday. lake effect snow. As we watch that cold front move through the area on Friday, behind it, the air is much, much colder. We'll see lake effect snow develop, more of a southwesterly wind, which means that band could make its way into downtown Buffalo, and that'll impact the area late Friday into Saturday before that band diminishes. Then we'll have a general snow Sunday morning, followed by more lake effect as we get into Sunday evening and Monday. Again, we're also tracking a blast of cold air. You can see that blue on the screen. That is going to be moving through the Great Lakes, bringing us colder air for the weekend and much colder air as we get into next Monday and Tuesday. Your forecast on for today: a high of 31 degrees, partly sunny skies with a cool breeze today. Tonight, overnight lows in the low 20s, partly cloudy and chilly. Tomorrow, we're in the mid-30s with sunshine. Friday, we start near 40 with rain and snow and wind and falling temperatures. Lake effect snow for Saturday. Lake effect snow again late Sunday into Monday. We'll continue to track this as new data comes in. We'll get you updated on how cold it's going to be, and we'll continue to track that lake effect for the weekend.
Thank you, Aaron. Coming up here on 7 Eyewitness News, bringing new life back to a Buffalo neighborhood.
The building itself has an appearance of a fortress.
Yeah, I think we can all agree it's not necessarily the most appealing. We're talking about the Broadway Market and how some big changes are giving neighbors hope for the future. But first, the Buffalo Strong Way, one local couple is helping a new business thrive during the pandemic. It's 6:23 on the start of a Wednesday morning. Stay with us. You're watching 7 Eyewitness News.
Welcome back. One couple's Buffalo strong spirit has led to a brand new business. Howard Cadmus and his wife own Sweet Jenny's, and then those couple of buildings around it. There's three of them total in the Williamsville Plaza. They're pumping big bucks into them to make sure the community can thrive. Then they saw that their friend Bill Reynolds had lost his job, and they knew he had been practicing martial arts for years. So they reached out and asked if he'd be interested in teaching their son. Well, those lessons turned into a new business.
It's important for the health of my son and kids like him, myself will be training, and I've trained in martial arts my whole life, and other people, to be able to have some sense of normality amidst what's going on.
The dojo is going to offer a variety of classes for people of all ages. There'll be a grand opening a week from Friday. More information about those classes right now at WKBW.com. You're watching 7 Eyewitness News at 6. We'll be right back on your Wednesday.
And we could enjoy it. Everyone profit, and that's the best thing that could happen for the city.
All new for you this morning at 6:30, how everyone in Buffalo's Broadway Fillmore neighborhood could benefit from a total revamp of the Broadway Market. Plus, the appointment hang-ups many people who are eligible to get that COVID-19 vaccine now face, and what's being done to help them get their shot. And a much calmer morning for the middle of the week, but wait until you see what's on the horizon and why it may need a few extra layers. Plus this:
I don't know when I'm going to feel comfortable walking down Elmwood again.
Addressing crime in the Elmwood Village after a seemingly random attack in broad daylight. We're getting answers from your community leaders.
Now broadcasting and streaming live from 7 Broadcast Plaza, this is 7 Eyewitness News at 6.
Good morning, everybody. As we start 6:30, thanks for joining us on this Wednesday. We've got a really interesting interview on the Elmwood Village coming up, and we got to get everybody out the door first.
That's right. We were talking about the snow yesterday. Today it's the warmth, but tomorrow and into the end of the week, Aaron, it's going to be all the cold.
Oh, yes, very active weather toward the end of the week and the weekend. Right now, it's pretty quiet outside. You have a cool breeze to start off your Wednesday. We had that snow last night. Now that snow is well off to our east. Looking into downtown Buffalo, we have partly cloudy skies, a chilly 23 degrees, winds out of the north-northwest at 12 miles per hour. So it feels like it's 12 outside. 22 in Niagara Falls, 20 in Jamestown, 18 right now in Olean. Winds will kick up to around 20 miles per hour today, and they'll be with us all day. So we'll have that cool breeze for your Wednesday. Hour by hour high resolution model showing partly cloudy skies today. Tomorrow we'll have a good deal of sunshine and kind of the quiet before the storm on Thursday before things really go downhill for the end of the week and the weekend. At the bus stop this morning, partly cloudy and chilly, low 20s this afternoon. Partly sunny skies with temperatures near 30 degrees.
Aaron, thank you. Our eyes are on the Broadway market this morning and on development in Western New York. The market getting ready for what's usually its busiest time of the year. There are new plans to help revitalize it for the future as well. You're looking at renderings of what the market could look like using funding from the Buffalo Billion. This is all with the goal to bring the market back to its glory days and attract some new visitors. Now, right now, this project's still in its planning stages, but developers think that this project could bring the Broadway Fillmore neighborhood a much needed boost.
It would be huge. 7 Eyewitness News reporter Taylor Epps is giving us an in-depth look at three big changes developers say will make the Broadway market a regional attraction.
And they just need to do a lot to just bring it back to what it used to be.
Many of us remember the Broadway market from years ago, the place that brought so many people together.
Great meats, good customer service, and it's been a monument around here for a long time.
Frank Cadera lives here in the neighborhood and stops by all the time. He really wants to see the market get a boost.
A good shot of the arm, you know, bring it up to par and everything, you know, up to status. And it's got potential.
That's exactly what Empire State Development recommends. After dozens of surveys, public hearings, and community Zoom meetings, they created a 400-page document laying out suggestions on how to revitalize the Broadway market.
And we want to help it get to where the rest of the city has gotten. It's, you know, lagged behind, and we want to make sure that the neighbors are involved.
There are three main changes they want to make. Number one, use of space.
Currently, about 30,000 or 6% of it is being utilized. The way to make it work is to fill that building up.
Aaron Zaretsky says the Broadway market is wasting space on parking. He's a public market expert with a history of transforming dozens of markets around the country. For change number two, Zaretsky says the market needs a bit of a makeover.
The building itself has an appearance of a fortress. Part of what we're proposing is to break through those walls and create storefronts that spill out onto the sidewalk.
He also suggests changing the name to the Broadway International Public Market, which brings us to change number three, embracing the diversity of the Broadway Fillmore area.
You know, when you stroll into the Broadway market, you can find four or five different places to buy Polish foods, but nothing for the African-American community, for the South Asian community, for the Muslim community.
The goal is to make the market a regional attraction, giving this community an economic boost.
And there's about 7 million people a year who visit Niagara Falls. I can see this being the second stop. Those people are not just going to shop at the Broadway market. They're going to shop in the broader neighborhood. They're going to create jobs. They're going to create economic opportunities.
Well, can you see yourself coming here more if those changes are made?
Yes, definitely, I would.
And we could enjoy it. Everyone profit, and that's the best thing that could happen for the city.
And Taylor joins us now live from her house. Taylor, good morning to you. You know, I love the Broadway market. It's one of my favorite places to visit in the city of Buffalo. And all things considered, it sounds like they're trying to make it like the West Side Bazaar. So you've shown us the plans. Where do we go from here?
Well, Ed, of course, all the pictures and the ideas sound great, but the one thing you really need to make this happen is money. The state says this is a $50 million plan that could take about 4 to 5 years to complete, and the state has already put up $4 million of that, and the next step is to work with the city and the county to raise the rest of the money to really bring life back to that Broadway Fillmore staple, Ed.
So a lot of money still needs to be raised here, and of course, years down the line, but still something to look forward to. Taylor, thank you. Another project will soon begin in the Queen City. A big chunk of Delaware Avenue from Forest Avenue to North Street is getting updated to make traffic safer. Neighbors want more done specifically to Gates Circle. The current plan is to paint traffic lines in the roundabout, but a design firm hired by neighbors believes more can be done to create better entrances to the circle. You can see the design firm's full report right now on WKBW.com. Katie.
This morning, in the race to get people vaccinated for COVID-19, Governor Cuomo says the state will be receiving a 20% increases in doses for the next 3 weeks. People who are eligible are hoping that that means getting an appointment will become a little bit easier. Christine Kasperzak from Cheektowaga, one of those people eligible to get the vaccine, she says she's tried to book an appointment by calling a number provided by the state. She was disconnected 8 times. When she finally got through, no surprise, there were no appointments.
Everything is, there's no appointments available, everything's gone. So I'm just hopeful that one of these days I'll be lucky. It's like the lottery. I'll just be lucky and get an appointment.
We just keep hearing this story over and over again. For now, Kasperzak says she's not sure she'll be able to get an appointment until June, because when she contacted her local pharmacy, they also, Ed, had a waiting list.
At 6:37, we're taking a close look at the availability of appointments around Western New York to give you the first alert about open vaccine appointments. So this morning and every morning, we're watching the websites to see if appointments are available near you. According to the state's Am I Eligible website, the only state-operated locations with the availability through April 16th are in Syracuse, Potsdam, and Plattsburgh. The State Distribution Center at UB has no appointments available. Even pharmacies like Tops and Wegmans are fully booked at this point. Tops getting very limited doses from the state. We know that. And right now, if you click on any of these locations, you see on the left-hand side of your screen, it says no appointments available. And you won't have much luck booking an appointment at Wegmans either this morning. When you try and book an appointment through its website, the message pops up saying all vaccine available appointments are reserved at this time. Again, we'll continue checking for you every morning so you know when you'll be able to get your shot. Coming up here on 7 Eyewitness News, new concerns about variants of COVID-19, what doctors are now learning about the mutations, and your body's reaction.
And so what we really tried to do is we tried to give them the tips and sort of tools that they need to be successful at that business.
And later this morning, a new tool that's helping those who are looking to start a business in a time when it's not exactly easy to do so, everything they need. Aaron.
Quiet weather for today and tomorrow, but Friday we'll have rain mixing with snow and then changing to lake effect snow late in the day as temperatures tumble. Low 20s on Saturday, tracking lake effect, which could be significant to start off the weekend, and then more snow on Sunday.
6:41 on a Wednesday morning. Here's what's good to know before you go. A new COVID-19 variant is raising concerns after early studies show antibody protection may not be enough. The mutation is an altered version of variants found in South Africa and Brazil. In addition to being more transmissible, it could become resistant to immune protection, but experts say it is too early to truly know the impact. Hundreds of people in the Southern Tier will lose their jobs through the middle of next year. Siemens Energy announcing it is cutting more than 500 jobs at its Olean manufacturing plant. Some employees will be transferred either to Painted Post near Elmira or Houston, Texas. It's part of the company's move to eliminate about 1,700 jobs in the U.S. by 2025. All Buffalo Sabres games have been postponed through at least next Monday. Taylor Hall and Rasmus Ristolainen now in the league's COVID-19 protocol. It does not necessarily mean they've tested positive for the virus. The postponement comes after the Sabres played two games against the Devils over the weekend. They have 10 players in the protocol. Next this morning, Buffalo leaders are addressing your safety concerns. Just after the break, we're going to be joined by Buffalo Councilman David Rivera to talk about crime in the Elmwood Village. But first, all this week, 7 Eyewitness News is celebrating Black History Month. We're Buffalo and beyond. So this morning, we recognize Ida Fairbush, the first Black school teacher in Buffalo Public Schools. In 1897, she was appointed to a full-time position teaching first grade at school number 6, making $550 a year. She spent her entire career at school 6 and retired 40 years later in 1937. We'll be right back.
Welcome back at 6:45. This morning, we're taking an in-depth look at crime in the Elmwood Village and whether it's on the rise.
It comes after a seemingly random assault took place a week ago. A couple was near Elmwood and West Ferry when a man walked towards them without any confrontation and stabbed the boyfriend. That victim's girlfriend said it happened so fast, there were no signs before that suspect would act violently.
Has us both on edge because you don't know why it happened. There was no reason. And
not been a rise in crime in the Elmwood Village, Ed.
But today, Buffalo police are holding a community meeting in a virtual forum between police and neighbors. But right now, crime in the Elmwood Village, of course, top of mind as neighbors share their concerns about their safety. So this morning, we're joined live by Zoom by Buffalo Councilman David Rivera about these concerns. Councilman, thank you so much for waking up early with us. We certainly appreciate you. Let's cut right to the chase here. That stabbing really front of mind on West Ferry and Elmwood. The idea here is we see it all happen. What is the update and where is this guy? Where's the investigation at this point?
Well, thank you, Ed. We're working with the Buffalo Police Department. First of all, we ascertain what had happened and then disseminate the information to the residents so they can be on the lookout as well. I have worked with the administration, the Byron Brown administration, the police commissioner, the deputy commissioner, the chiefs, and the lieutenants to make sure the resources that we need to solve these incidents or these rash of crimes in the Elmwood Village are brought to some conclusion. So we work with the residents continually. We ask them to be very cautious, to take precautions in terms of being alone. And we've seen different types of crimes, from stabbing, from an attempted robbery, a carjacking. So we've seen a spike in crime in the Elmwood Village. We don't know the motivations, like you mentioned.